Our gracious Heavenly Father, again, that is our prayer today, that you will open our minds, our hearts, our ears to thy word. We ask your blessings upon your manservant, Pastor Barry, as he breaks the bread of life to us. Again, may our hearts be receptive to thy word. Fill us with thy spirit, we pray in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, our High Priest, and your only begotten Son. Amen.
Amen. Where in the world is Minot, North Dakota? One of my cousins sent me a message on Facebook. He said, why don't you just move to the North Pole, Barry? Well, it's not the North Pole, but you can see it from there. So, next October 8th will be our last Sabbath here with you, and we're going to miss each and every one of you. It's been a wonderful little more than a year, and just want to let you know we were not looking to move. We are fully satisfied here, and but anyway, God has plans sometimes that are almost beyond our understanding. And so our last Sabbath in the district will be at Eastern Carolina Camp Meeting, October 22nd. And then from there we'll transition on. I want to take a moment just to recognize one of our ministries, that does so much for Little Creek, and yet you never see them. They're always behind the scenes. So if I could get the AV department to turn camera two up there and give us a wave and a shout out. We appreciate all that our media department does for Little Creek. And we'll give them a second to get the camera set there and give us a wave, maybe put it up on the screen so we can see it here. And we thank you all so much for your part in this ministry. We welcome you who are joining us online. And welcome as we reflect this Sabbath and this month on the great things that God has done for us here in Little Creek, in Clayton, North Carolina. God has blessed us tremendously. And so the remarks that I have today are not my own. I'm going to be presenting you several characters from Advent Heritage, and I'll do that as much as I can in the first person. And so I want to be speaking you as several characters. I wish I had a different costume or something, but I'll try and change my voice so you can follow along. If we turn back to Genesis chapter 3, if you were to turn back to Genesis chapter 3, you would see that as a family, we have been putting the fun in dysfunction for a long time. It's true. It all began back there with a piece of fruit. And God has extended an unconditional covenant through Adam to put enmity between our family and the serpent. Through Noah, God has extended his unconditional covenant to all flesh. And through Abraham, God has extended his unconditional covenant of grace to every generation of those who believe. God honors our choices to respond to him with obedience by faith in the perfect Son of God, or to spurn his grace and leave the family. And as we go through the experiences today shared by brethren who began this work over 100 years ago, we will see that there's both trial and triumph and tragedy, as there is in our lives and families still today. This work is based on the Great Second Advent Movement, Its Rise and Progress by J.N. Loughborough, by Joseph Bates' autobiography, and letters and articles from E.G. White and William Miller. So I can take no credit for this presentation. I'll just simply do the best that I can at being each of those individuals as they come in our presentation. As we begin, notice with me on the screen this paragraph from Review and Herald, October 12th, 1905. The work is soon to close. The members of the church militant who have proved faithful and become the church will become the church triumphant. In reviewing our past history, having traveled over every step of advance of our present standing, I can say praise God. As I see what God has wrought, I am filled with astonishment and with confidence in Christ as leader. We have nothing to fear for the future except as we shall forget the way that God has led us and his teaching in our past. The first character that I will take on this morning is Franklin Edson Belden. Franklin wrote the hymn that we just sung a few moments ago, Holy Thine, and many others. I was born March 21, 1858, Franklin Edson Belden at Battle Creek, Michigan, and died December 2nd, 1945 at Marshall, Michigan. During my lifetime, the American Civil War, the Indian Wars, the Banana Wars, World War I, and World War II signaled a time of conflict and conquest, fueled by the Industrial Revolution. I am at rest in Oak Hill Cemetery, Battle Creek, Michigan. I'm the most prolific writer of hymns, tunes, gospel songs, and related texts in the early years of Seventh-day Adventist Church, and was referred to as the sweet singer of Israel. I am known for my ability to compose hymns spontaneously as sermons are being delivered, and to perform them at the conclusion of the service. I'm the oldest of five children born to Stephen and Sarah Harmon Belden, oldest sister of Ellen Harmon White, and thus she is my aunt. I began writing music in the late teenage years after a move to California with my family, and for health reasons I moved to Colorado, where I met and then married Harriet McDearman, also a talented musician, in 1881. We returned to Battle Creek in the early 1880s, where I became involved in the Adventist publishing work. Edwin Barnes, a talented musician who had recently moved to Battle Creek from England, and I served as musical editors on Hymns and Tunes, a collection of over 1,100 hymns contributed, published by the Adventist Church in 1886. In my late 20s, I contributed over 80 texts and 87 tunes to this collection, and also later collaborated with my cousin, J. Edson White, on several songbooks. My name is associated with Christ in Song. Anyone heard of Christ in Song? The most popular songbook ever published by the church. I started working on the collection in 1884 as Hymns and Tunes was nearing completion. In 1900, I personally published the completed work, which is then sold through Review and Herald. In 1905, a disagreement between myself and the brethren at General Conference arose over the royalties of Hymns and Tunes. Although it was reported that I was greedy and just wanted money, in reality, I was upset over the breaking of the original agreement voted by the General Conference in 1885. That all royalties from sales of Hymns and Tunes would support the church's mission work. I had agreed to contribute my music only under this condition. When the church's publishing entities were consolidated as the Review and Herald Publishing Association and the copyright was assigned to it, I did not want my share going to the publishing house. And I wrote an extended letter in 1905 protesting that assignment. The matter remained unresolved, and I, becoming disillusioned, separated myself from Adventism, but not from the Christian faith. In 1907, myself, now widely known for my hymn writing and leadership in the church, and a number of other prominent Adventists were expelled from the church and branded as apostates and heretics by a committee. This decision and others made at a time when the church was in turmoil over theological issues was reported in the July 12, 1907 Cass City Chronicle in Michigan. The announcement was met by dismay by myself and those who were expelled and other members of the church. The following year, I published a revised and expanded edition of Christ in Song, which I hoped would serve as a church hymnal and Sabbath school songbook and would appeal to the young. This version would become the favorite song collection with members of the church for decades, and it is still available to this day. Near the end of my work on Christ in Song, I began writing songs for the noted evangelist Billy Sunday, which were included in the Songs for the King's Business. And even though it was published in 1909 by Sunday School Supply House in Chicago, it was advertised in the Review and Herald and available through the Review and Herald Publishing Association. My uncanny ability to rapidly pen both music and poetry enabled me to write a song to fit a sermon while it was still being delivered. At the end of the service, my wife and I would perform the newly created song. We would then give a copy of the manuscript to the preacher as a souvenir. Following my death in 1945 at age 87, my papers and manuscripts were purchased for $1,000 by the church. You can view them today at Andrews University, Berrien Springs, Michigan. The 1941 church hymnal included 22 of my songs and hymns. The 1985 Seventh-day Adventist hymnal includes 12 complete hymns and 4 tunes written by me, more than provided by any other Adventist contributor. Notice with me on the screen the words of Paul. Do you not know that we are to judge? I'm sorry, you're not following me here. There we go. This is what it's based on. I'm sorry, we'll back up and rerun here. This is where you can find the resources that I'm sharing with you today. This is the quote that I read earlier. I'm sorry you didn't see all this. Here we are, Paul. Do you not know we are to judge angels? How much more than matters pertaining to this life? So if you have such cases, why do you lay them before those who have no standing in the church? I say this to your shame. Can it be that there is no one among you wise enough to settle a dispute between brothers, but brother goes against brother, to the law against brother, and that before unbelievers? To have lawsuits at all with one another is already a defeat for you. Why not rather suffer wrong? Why not rather be defrauded? But you yourselves wrong and defraud even your own brothers. 1 Corinthians 6, 5 through 7. This next two paragraphs comes at the end of a letter from my aunt, Ellen White. And you can look the rest of the letter up and read it this afternoon, but I'll share this couple of paragraphs with you where she really uses the tone from Paul there. Those against whom you bring your charges know that I have not approved of their manner of dealing with you, and that I have reproved them for their unfeeling management of your case. There are those who have not acted honorably. They have not done as they would be done by. But because of this, should you, in the face of the warnings given, move so manifestly against the instruction given? I beg of you not to cut yourself off from the confidence of your brethren and from taking a part in the publishing work. I would rather share your loss than to have you push this matter through to the injury of your soul, giving Satan an opportunity to present your case before unbelievers in a most ridiculous light, and to hold up the office of publication in a disparaging light. Take this case out of the lawyer's hands. It seems awful to me to think that we will go directly contrary to the plain word of God and will open to the world your cruel work against God's commandment-keeping people. If this action of yours were to tell only against those who have done injustice, the harm would not be so far-reaching. But can you not see that it will arouse prejudice against God's people as a body? Thus you will bruise and wound Christ in the person of his saints and cause Satan to exalt because through you he could work against God's people and against his instructions, doing them great harm. Letter 301, October 20, 1905. Next we have J.N. Loughborough, writer of the work that we're considering today. And I'll share with you the publisher's call to remember from the 1992 edition. Above all, a review of historical events gives us an opportunity to trace God's hand at work, to see evidences of his loving care. This builds faith and teaches us the lessons of the past, both positive and negative. It reveals the sacrificial spirit of our pioneers. It recalls our spiritual roots. As Brother Loughborough states on page 33, if it was good for Israel to call to remembrance the leadings of the Lord with them, is it not good also for us? In ecstasy, the psalmist again says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits." Psalm 103 and verse 2. The years of the founding of the Seventh-day Adventist work was one of the special times in history. Even more special, consider this. When major transitions in the anti-typical real sanctuary service occur, since God's way is in the sanctuary, Psalm 77, 13, it is critical to understand and follow by faith what God is doing to handle the sin problem. Notice, God will handle the sin problem. It's not our job. Particularly helpful in this is the parallel between the preceding major transition of the one in the Advent Awakening. The Lord would have us reflect on what happened at the move from the courtyard to the holy place, from Calvary to the Ascension, and how the godly people of that time initially misunderstood what occurred and thereby experienced a very trying disappointment, but finally came to see their place in the unfolding of God's plan. Their experience shines a light on that of the believers of 1844 and following at the transition from the holy place to the Holy of Holies, from intercession to intercessory judgment. John Norton Loughborough was an eyewitness to the founding of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. A brief overview of his own words and his life and ministry will give a background to the 1992 edition of his 1905 work, The Great Second Advent Movement, Its Rise and Progress. I was born in Victor, Ontario County, New York, January 26, 1832. This village of 200 or more inhabitants was surrounded by a settled farming community for miles. It was on the old mail stage line between Albany and Buffalo. This village was where I attended Sunday school and public service until the spring of 1848, when the city of Rochester, New York, became my headquarters. Both my father and grandfather were local ministers in the Methodist Church, but supported themselves. In the last week of December 1843, I heard my first discourse of Advent preaching. It was from Brother James Berry on the topic, "The Hour of His Judgment Is Come." The mighty power of God set home the truth he proclaimed. It seemed as though we were standing before the judgment bar of God. Under the exhortation that followed from the pastor, I and many others pressed forward to the front to be prayed for, and this began my first effort to pray and seek God. In the winter of 1852, before I had begun to preach the third angel's message or sustain myself and wife by hand labor, a vision was given Sister White in our meeting in Rochester on Sabbath And a direct testimony was given to me to hesitate no longer, but to go out and preach the message, and the Lord would open the way for me to be sustained. When I had got fairly into the work in those early times, there were manifest what then was a mystery to me. It was this: in every important meeting in different states that Brother and Sister White attended, they would call me to go with them. I would say to myself, why do they not call these other ministers instead of me all the time? Then again, when those three rebellions came on from 1853 to 1865, when they started three different papers, to one for each of those tirades, why was it that I was present and saw each of the rebellions start? Then again, why was it that I was present to see Sister White in open visions over 40 different times, see her examined by physicians, hear her make predictions of what was to take place, things that seemed incredible to those hearing them, and yet literally fulfilled? I say in all candor, these opportunities were not an occasion of exaltation to me, but a mystery. I would say to myself, why is all this so? In 1890, I was requested by the General Conference to labor east of the Rocky Mountains. Then came this testimony written by Elder O.A. Olson, of which a copy was also sent to me. I say, let Elder Loughborough do a work that is suffering to be done in the churches. The Lord would have his voice heard, as was John's, telling the things which he himself has experienced in the rise and progress of the third angel's message. Let Elder Loughborough stand in his right place as Caleb coming to the front, bearing a decided testimony in face of unbelief and doubt and skepticism. We be well able to go and possess the goodly land, Numbers 13:30. Do not fasten Elder Loughborough in a corner anywhere. Do not bind him to one conference. Let him go here and there and everywhere, telling what he has seen and known and handled in the rise and progress of the third angel's message. I've penned this preface to my 1905 edition. There are already many useful books in the hands of the people, and my apology for adding another to this list is that in these pages I state many things concerning Adventists, and especially Seventh-day Adventists, which have not heretofore been brought in this form before the people. Besides this, many who espoused the cause in later years and who have not witnessed the things mentioned have earnestly requested a narration of these facts and experiences from those earlier in the work. Having been familiar with the Advent movement from 1843 and 1844, and having since January 2, 1849, proclaimed the doctrine, first as an Adventist and since 1852 as a Seventh-day Adventist, I esteem it a pleasure to speak the things I have seen and heard, Acts 4:20. I have presented a statement concerning the Advent movement, which from 1831 to 1844 spread to every civilized nation of the world. Since 1845, there have been other bodies of Adventists which have proclaimed and are still proclaiming the near advent of Christ. Instead of tracing those bodies, it has been my purpose to give at some length the rise and progress of the Seventh-day Adventists, calling a special attention to those agencies which, in the providence of God, have aided in developing from poverty and small beginnings a people of whom, although they only number about 100,000, some of their opponents have said, from the energy and zeal with which they work, one would judge them to be over 2 million. Do we have that energy and zeal today? Even those who are only slightly conversant with that Seventh-day Adventist history know that since 1845, Mrs. E.G. White has been prominently connected with the movement, both as speaker and writer. They also know that connected with her work, there have been these many peculiar exercises and gifts. It has been my privilege to be present and to witness the operation of this gift about 50 times. In these pages, I have called attention to some 26 definite predictions made by Mrs. White, which have most accurately been fulfilled. In addition to my own observations, I've also presented testimony of other eyewitnesses respecting their experiences. Such facts should have more weight with the candid reader than random statements made by those who have never been present on such occasions. I commit the work to the readers, hoping that, with the blessing of God, the perusal of these pages may be a means of promoting the cause of Christ in many hearts, trusting that all, as they read, will bear in mind the words of Paul to the Thessalonians, "Prove all things, hold fast that which is good." 1 Thessalonians 5:21. J.N. Loughborough, Mountain View, California, May 1, 1905. Next, we have this from Herbert E. Douglas in his work Messenger of the Lord, page 38 and 39, published by Pacific Press, 1998. "More relevant," he writes, "to early Seventh-day Adventists are the experiences of William Foy and Hazen Foss. Both had visions similar to the first vision given to Ellen Harmon. William Ellis Foy, 1818 to 1893, a black American in his early 20s, received several dramatic visions in 1842, several years prior to those received by Hazen Foss and Ellen Harmon. My first one, January 18, lasted 2.5 hours, and the second, February 4, 12.5 hours. My physical condition in the visions resembled Daniel's trance-like state. Sometime before October 22, 1844, Ellen Harmon heard me speak in Beethoven Hall in Portland, Maine. A few weeks later, shortly after her first vision in December of 1844, I was present at a meeting near Cape Elizabeth, Maine, during which she spoke of her first vision. As she began, I became engrossed in what she was saying. I was caught up in the enthusiasm and pathos that accompanied her presentation. She talked of heavenly things, of guides, of lights, of imagery familiar to me. Caught up in the jubilant moment, I could hold back no longer. All of a sudden, right in the middle of Ellen's presentation, I let out a shout of joy, rose to my feet, and excitedly jumped right up and down. As Ellen remembered, "Oh, he praised the Lord. Praised the Lord." He repeated again and again that her vision was just what he had seen. He knew that there was no way to falsify such an experience as hers. It was legitimate. In 1906, Ellen White recalls her conversation with William Foy. She remembered that he had four visions, all before her first vision. They were written out and published, and it is odd that I cannot find them in any of my books, but we've moved so many times. Then she gave Foy a very meaningful compliment. "It was remarkable testimonies he bore." Hazen Foss met Ellen Harmon in January 1845 at a meeting in Poland, Maine. Here Ellen had been invited by Mary Foss, her sister, to relate her first vision of a month earlier. Hazen, Mary's brother-in-law — Mary was the wife of Samuel Foss — is remembered as a man of fine appearance, pleasing address, and education. "Prior to October 22, 1844, I had a vision depicting the journey of the Adventists, then called Millerites, to the City of God. I was instructed to make known the vision along with specific messages of warning, but I declined. After October 22, I felt that I had been misled by my earlier vision. In my second vision, I was warned that if I was not faithful in relating the first vision, the vision and the responsibility would be taken from me and given to one with much fewer qualifications. I continued to dread the potential ridicule and rejection of my fellow Millerites. Finally, I believed I heard a voice saying, 'You have grieved away the Spirit of the Lord.' Frightened by this prospect, I called a meeting to relate the vision. But after making several unsuccessful attempts to recall it, I declared, it is gone from me. I can say nothing. The Spirit of the Lord has left me. Some in attendance reported the meeting was the worst meeting they were ever in. After this experience, I met Ellen in Poland, Maine. Though invited into the meeting, I remained outside the closed door, though close enough to hear her message. The next day, I told Ellen, the Lord gave me a message to bear to his people, and I refused after being told the consequences. I was proud. I was unreconciled with the disappointment. I heard your talk last night. I believe the visions are taken from me and given to you. Do not refuse to obey God, for it will be at the peril of your soul. I am a lost man. You are chosen of God. Be faithful in doing your work, and the crown that I might have had, you will receive. Elder Joseph Bates, third co-founder of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. My honored father and his forefathers were for many years residents of the town of Wareham, Plymouth County, state of Massachusetts. My mother was the daughter of Mr. Barnabas Nye, the town of Sandwich, Barnstable County, both towns but a few hours' ride from the noted landing place of the Pilgrim Fathers. My father was a volunteer in the Revolutionary War, and after the war, he married and settled in Rochester, an adjoining town in Plymouth County, where I was born July 8, 1792. In the early part of 1793, we moved to New Bedford, some 7 miles distant, where my father entered into commercial business. During the war with England in 1812, the town of New Bedford was divided, and the eastern part was called Fairhaven. This has ever been my place of residence until I moved my family to Michigan in 1858. In my schoolboy days, my most ardent desire was to become a sailor. I used to think how gratified I should be if I could only get on board a ship that was going on a voyage of discovery round the world. I wanted to see how it looked on the opposite side. Whenever I thought of asking my father's consent to let me go to sea, my courage failed me for fear he would say no. When I would endeavor to unburden my mind to my mother, she would try to dissuade me, recommend some other occupation. Till at last I was permitted to go on a short trip with my uncle to Boston, etc., to cure me. But this had the opposite effect. They then complied with my wishes. A new ship called the Fanny of New Bedford, Elias Terry, commander, was about to sail for Europe, and he agreed with my father to take me on the voyage as cabin boy. In June 1807, we sailed from New Bedford to take our cargo on board New York City for London, England. And just listen to this account as a parallel of our spiritual journey. On our passage to New York City, we sailed by way of Long Island Sound. In this route, several miles from the city, it is a very narrow and dangerous passage, bounded with rocks on the right and rock-bound shore on the left, called Hurl Gate. What makes it so dangerous is the great rush of water that passes through this narrow channel. As the tide ebbs and flows each way, it rushes with such impetuosity that few dare venture to sail through against it without strong, steady wind in their favor. For want of watchfulness and care, many vessels have been whirled from their course in the rushing foam and hurled against the rocks, wrecked and lost in a few moments' time. Sailors call it Hellgate. As our gallant ship was bringing us in sight of this dreadful place, the pilot took the helm and requested the captain to call all hands on deck. He then stationed us in various parts of the ship for the purpose of managing the sails in case of emergency according to his judgment. He then requested us to remain silent while passing this dangerous gateway, that we might better understand his orders. In this way, every man and boy at our post, and our eyes silently fixed on the pilot, waiting his orders, our good ship winged her way through the hurling foam and passed on safely to her anchorage before the city. The experienced and thorough knowledge of our pilot in guiding our gallant ship safely through the dangerous gateway with the stillness and breathless attention of her crew were stamped deeply in my mind. Promptness and exertion in perilous times on the ocean has, with the blessing of God, saved thousands of souls from a watery grave. There are many experiences I could share at sea, the various journey of my spiritual life, but let us get to the message at hand, the Advent message. Previous to the foregoing occurrence, and while the subjects of anti-slavery and pro-slavery were agitating the nation, a wonderful phenomenon occurred in the heavens which caused consternation and dismay among the people, namely, the stars falling from heaven. Many watchmen in the cities and sailors in their night watches on the ocean, together with those who were up and their friends whom they called up to witness the exhibition of the falling stars, were now relating what they had witnessed, as also were the newspapers of the times. I'll share this paragraph from Baltimore Patriot. Mr. Monroe, being this morning, November 13, 1833, being up this morning, November 13, 1833, I witnessed one of the most grand and alarming spectacles which ever beamed upon the eye of man. The light in my room was so great that I could see the hour of the morning by my watch which hung over my mantle. And supposing that there were a fire near at hand, probably on my own premises, I sprung to the window and behold, the stars or some other bodies presenting a fiery appearance were descending in torrents as rapid and as numerous as ever I saw flakes of snow or drops of rain in the midst of storm. In connection with these portentous signs in the heavens, moral reform was working its way like leaven through the United States. To all appearance, some unseen agency was assisting those who were struggling in the uphill work of opposing the masses while they were soliciting and enlisting the energies and sympathies of men, women, and children to help stay the tide of intemperance and slavery, which, to all human appearance, if not stayed, would demoralize and debase us below the moral standard of the civilized nations of the earth before the close of the then rising generation. What appeared the most inexplicable in moving forward this work was to see ministers whose Christian characters were before unsullied in the community, pleading in favor of slavery, upholding rum drinking and rum selling, and keeping a large majority of their church and congregation under their influence. Others were mute, waiting to see how their friends would decide. Some there were, however, who took a noble stand in the work of reform. In the fall of 1839, while engaged in my orchard, one Elder R., an acquaintance of mine, a preacher of the Christian Connection, also James White was a member there, called upon me and inquired if I would like to go to New Bedford, about 2 miles distance that evening, and hear him preach on the second coming of Christ. I obliged, and as we were returning after that evening with my companion after a silent ride, I explained, "That is the truth." My companion replied, "Oh, you are so sanguine always." But we would hear more of this. According to the signs of the times published by J.V. Himes, September 1 and 15, a general conference on the coming of our Lord was called for in Boston, Massachusetts. I, Joseph Bates, along with J.V. Hines and others, signed that work. The Spirit of the Lord had pervaded the meeting, which lasted 2 days from its commencement, but it was now seemed to vibrate and move the whole congregation. The singing of the hymn, "When Thou, My Righteous Judge, Shalt Come." And with the Spirit and with understanding, we took communion. About 200 of us of different denominations. Thank the Lord now for that joyous occasion. During the month of August 1842, a second Advent camp meeting was held in Littleton, Massachusetts. This was the first camp meeting I'd ever attended. It was quite a novel thing to see a variety of tents pitched around the minister's stand among the tall, shady trees. At the opening of the meeting, we learned that those who occupied them were families of the various towns and vicinity of the camp and the city of Lowell who were interested in the Advent doctrine. The subject of the prophecies connected with the second coming of our blessed Lord and Savior was the theme of ministers and people. All except a mob who came to break up the meeting seemed deeply interested, and those becoming acquainted with the nature of the meeting ceased to trouble us, and peace, harmony, and love prevailed during the entire meeting. Here's a picture that I took last summer at Andrews University of Joseph Bates' Bible. As the story goes, he left this with my great-great-great-grandparents the last time he stayed in their home as a circuit-riding preacher in central Michigan. Don't know whether it's true or not, but that's what I've always been told. And so when I was at Andrews last year, I sought it out at the James White Library and took this photo. But we have a heritage all the way back to Adam and Eve that is troubled. It's only by God's grace that He gives us victory and unity in Christ. Amen. We have the awesome opportunity to respond to His great love because He knows everything about us. We surprise ourselves sometimes. Well, I didn't know she could do that, or I didn't know he went there. God knows all about us, and yet and still, He's extended His amazing grace to us. Thank you, choir, for that song. In closing, let's stand and sing a hymn of Joseph or James White, 1849, possibly by an Effie Belden arrangement from Hymns and Tunes. What heavenly music.
What heavenly music.
Lord, comfort the afflicted in our family and afflict those who are too comfortable, that together we may love one another because you first loved us, and that through Christ Jesus our Lord, that confession and confession of faith, we may be perfected in your great love. May we experience a settled assurance through him who is able to keep us from falling until the day of his glorious appearing. In Jesus' almighty name we plead. Amen.